Thank you. It's actually a wonderful day for us to welcome such eminent panelists here. We of course have, my colleague just mentioned, we have representations from various segments of the internet and mobile companies today. And of course, we have Sandeep Berry here who would help us with the legal and the knowledge about global air trends. Now, the topic of today's discussion is complex challenges. The complex challenges of internet and mobile and e-commerce space, especially in the context of handling intermediary liability, security, privacy, and the frauds. There's no doubt that this particular space is expanding, growing, and therefore, you know, the scale and complexity that it poses. If you look at who are internet intermediaries, we have OECD who talks about internet intermediaries bringing together or facilitating third-party transactions. Now, given this particular framework of third-party transactions, independent third-party transactions, we have with us Neil Kanton, whose company actually has redefined matchmaking today. Then, of course, we have Sumit from Paytm, you know, modifying how we make payments. And then we have Ashish from Snapdeal, really changing how we shop and how we browse for products. So just talking about intermediary liabilities, you know, in the internet and mobile space, you know, typically a customer or when they actually use these kind of enabling technologies or platforms, they're actually transacting on a screen, right? So, you know, my question to you is that it's very essential to build an environment of trust here. Not just with the, and it's both ways because you're intermediaries. So you know how critical, how important is this as a business? And you know, do you treat this more as responsibility or is it about liabilities?
I'll take the question. I think it's not a responsibility. Let me put it very simply. It's actually business. Simple. I take more precautions. I give more privacy settings. First privacy setting is a username and a password. Basic. Then you go into, say, BharatMatrimony. You have the photograph. You can hide your photograph. Put a password to it. Circulate only to needed. You can hide your horoscope. Circulate only to needed. Customer uses it or not is not in my hand. That is where the customer generated content or customer generated requests works well. Now, as you asked the question, is it an obligation for us to do it? No. Is it a safety feature? Yes. Should we do it? Yes. If look at 66E, it says set some kind of a privacy settings there. So, legally, there is a grey language available in law today in relation to privacy, though it talks about more in terms of bad content instead of securing something in case of a bad situation, which happened in the Bazi matter. So they had that only in the background when they drafted 66C. I know that's a very bad way of drafting it in the first place. I disagree with it, personally disagree with it, maybe somebody else may agree. But there are other privacy issues as well, which have never been addressed. And that gives the leverage to the industry to be more agile, to adapt itself without the government interference. Would that answer your question?
So the way I look at it is it's positive, right? So, you know, Ashish, from your perspective, you know, responsibility, liability, how does it work?
So I think it is a responsibility, like your Neil Kanton said, on both sides, because traffic has to flow on both the side. And I think the responsibility, how it has been discharged by mature company like ours and theirs, is that one is that you have to adhere to the boundaries of the law, right? Where I think Neil Kanton and I'm sure Sandeep, you know, will have his own views. Is that we have different variety of laws for each type of business. Let's say for your payment services, the law of data protection and your privacy is different under RBI. if you talk about telecom services, the data protection encryption laws are different under the telecom laws. For other intermediary like us, we have ITX. So one is that, yes, you have to make sure that your base is actually covered. But for a mature company like ours and theirs, it's more about your own reputation in the market, right? If you have built that reputation and processes which gives confidence to the users to get accustomed to your site, one is that you use a particular site which you will use once in a month, once in a year. Second, where the consumer evolves is that you have adopted to a particular website. Like I become a perpetual user of Snapdeal to shop for my goods. I become a perpetual user of Paytm to pay for my all services. If I have to reach from a user to an adoption level, it's not about what basic law you're complying for the data privacy, it's about your inherent security practices. Now, one more point which I want to add, and after that we will take more questions from you, is that I think important part is it is an opportunity. One is that yes, it's an obligation, it is a liability, but I think from our standpoint, it's an opportunity. I was attending one of the session where, you know, one of the big stalwart, I won't name him, so he asked us a question that what do you think in last 5 years have extinct in technology? And the answer was very simple, like your tape recorders, your VCRs, your other things, because, you know, we don't see them, it's all your smartphone. So he asked, what will get extinct in next 5 years? Where you should be putting your money? Where you should be valuing the company at $1 billion? So people had their own question, their own responses, but his response was, which I liked very well, is that the human brain will get extinct. Why? Because everything will get interpreted and responded through artificial intelligence. We all have seen in the newspaper the term called as artificial intelligence, which is a 10 step forward from your big data, right? And we talk about smart cities, we talk about Internet of Things. So it will capture all your movement, it will capture even your pulse rate, it will capture even your moods, it will capture even your body temperature and will send the signal to your AC or to your heater to change accordingly, right? It will also sensor that, okay, if you are feeling cold in the month of October, then it will send a message to a Snapdeal. You know, you throw a sweater advertisement to Ashish Chandra in October rather than throwing it in the month of December. So that artificial intelligence will basically govern the human mind. Are we prepared to handle that opportunity with sophisticated data protection, data analytics tools? The world is going over there, while we should make sure that the base is, I mean, covered. But are we, they, or lawyers, in fact, are prepared for that, where artificial intelligence would be the buzzword? What kind of data protection laws, what kind of data privacy policy, security policy, what kind of behavioral targeting will get evolved that way? So, I mean, I'm just saying that from obligation and liability, this is a huge opportunity which is lying ahead. Are we prepared? I think we are, but we have to travel a lot.
Wow, so it's kind of scary what you said just now. I mean, we don't really want to be extinct, right?
No, that's not scary. That is what we have to change a mindset. I mean, I'm sure that we all have some maids at the house, you know. So we allow a third party to enter into our house, look at where I have kept my fancy show pieces and all. That's also you're opening your, I mean, private, your area to an outsider, but you are doing it because you get comfort. Now imagine, I mean, I sleep at a particular temperature because I have just come back from office. In the night, my body temperature is different. But my AC runs or my heater runs at the same temperature. Morning, you know, when I get up, I feel a bit odd that I don't want to go to office. I'm not feeling well. Why? Because my body is changing its temperature, but the room is at some temperature. Now imagine that kind of data, which is artificial intelligence, is being fed into a microchip which you put on your wristband, and it gives a message to your air conditioner that now please increase your temperature from 22 to 24 because my body temperature has now increased. So it's not scary. It is going to improve your life to a great extent, right? So I think we also have to change our mindset. That's why it's a two-way traffic.
Yeah,
right?
So the consolation is that it's the human brain that will design these systems. But, you know, going back to Sumit, you know, in terms of intermediary liability and, you know, the space that you operate in, which is financial payments, I think one of the biggest reasons why why any frauds or any breaches happen. What as a company do you see this as an opportunity, as a challenge, liability versus responsibility?
So I think one of the things which is more important for us as a payment player is about that, since it's about money and any breach of this will accumulate into a financial fraud which has much more legal repercussions and problems for us or and for the customer as well, because the damage or the injury is very exact or can be easily seen. So I think in terms of responsibility, yes, it's a big responsibility that we have. And I also agree with Ashish that it's an opportunity for us, because it also provides you an opportunity that you are able to provide the same convenience to your customer, because you will have the technological bandwidth, you will have the mindset, and you will have the people who will design the product in a way that without actually harming you are able to capture the intent, what you would want, and make your life convenient and make the product more usable. Also, but it's always a challenge, because at times you go a bit too far and there can be like, so a use case I may just quote that, for example, you are a diabetes patient and there is a glucometer which is attached to your band which determines how much insulin you need to be injected by. Now the system is connected with a hospital management system. Now just assume that this hospital management system does get compromised. You are injected with much higher amount of insulin than you require and you die. So I can kill you, or a hacker can kill you from wherever he's sitting, and so it's a big risk. Because, and whatever risk or things we are exposing to the internet and to the overall network, it just opens up a new avenue of bad things people can do to you. And therefore, you have to be absolutely careful about what is critical for you and what are the critical systems and critical data. You have to be extremely strict about how do you use them and how do you actually provide it to your customers and merchants. So most of the times, in terms of, if I have to put it very layman terms, it is all about capturing the right intent and securing the process and the product as much as possible. And so I will also, maybe if you required, I can also talk about how difficult it sometimes becomes to design a good product, given that it will be system controlled. But
yeah,
maybe
so we'll I think come to that as a differentiator. But coming to you, Sandeep, in terms of, you know, trends that we are seeing globally with evolving business models, and how you know, somebody like Paytm didn't exist when the Information Technology Act was first drafted in the country versus today. I mean, how is the global and legal scenario changing with time? What are the key points of concern that we are seeing? How are the governments reacting to it?
I think I agree with everything that you know, the three panelists have said in terms of opportunity and responsibility. I would just add that I think whether it becomes more of a responsibility or opportunity often depends on, you know, a lot of other social and political factors, and that also affects the global trend. So, you know, obviously one of the most recent examples is the attacks in Paris, right? So when something like that happens, for anybody, even in a democratic society, to say that I'm not going to vote for extreme measures which will limit some of your rights becomes very difficult, right? So it becomes very easy for the French government to say that I'm not going to allow the app that enables you to encrypt messages over your, you know, various websites or communications. So therefore, I think the one important thing for us to remember is that, and I'll address your question about the trends, but I think one important thing to remember is that the trends are always a product of, I would say, the most recent social or political events. And therefore, I think the point that Neil made, that, you know, the legislative response, etc., when it's done only in the context of most recent events, doesn't necessarily serve our, you know, long-term goals of balancing different considerations. But basically on the trends, you know, as, I think as we all know, there have been three broad approaches to addressing issues of intermediary liability. One is the strict liability approach, where you're liable for everything, every content on your website. The other extreme is where you have no liability at all, which is the prevalent law in the United States, for example. And the third one, which is the more EU and India type of approach, is that, okay, if you fulfill certain conditions, you won't have liability. And you know, I don't want to sort of jump ahead, but you know, maybe once you get, I'm sure you'll be talking about Shreya Singhal and so on, then you know, we can add on to that.
Right, so Neil, if I go to you, you know, if you look at the liability perspective, what have been the challenges that you as a company have faced? I mean, you're dealing with the kind of data and the kind of service that you offer. Clearly, there is no return, right? I mean, Snapdeal can always be offer a no question asked return, but you can't, right? So what have been the challenges? You've been here for long, I mean, as a service provider.
So let me answer it in two parts, and maybe one, I'll add a sub-part to it as well. But the way problems are faced is always, and I'm quoting myself in the context that in Bharat Matrimony at least, I haven't found a case where the company was at fault ever. It was always a customer-to-customer interaction outside the system of Bharat Matrimony, which only introduced these two people, happening on a Facebook, never on a WhatsApp. On a Facebook page or on a page which is of, say for instance, mobile SMS, and in worst case scenario, a Yahoo chat or a Google chat. Now, all the money gets transacted through the Indian banking systems. Vulnerable people end up paying lakhs and lakhs of rupees, assuming to get quickly rich or get some expensive gift, and end up being plundered. That's the basic problem. This is the one set of financial loss. The other set of information that happens is, police will come up way in the night one day and say, this is very emergency, get it now. The reason for it now is because somebody has breached somebody's privacy. And that being a content which can be loaded on the internet, they want to know which is the IP address which he was always used, how can we track him down to arrest him immediately, and that's the kind of work that happens on the back end of things. So frauds are not something which is related to the company's operation, because it's a machine and there's no human intervention, so there is hardly any problem there for an intermediary. It's only when the customer puts precaution on the back seat or the backmost seat, and richness or, you know, intimacy in the front seat, that caution to wind takes the toll of a fraud. To compound this, this is a sub part of it, the compound this is, it goes to a policeman who is not a cyber cell expert. So you're actually trying to talk to a person who has no clue of what he's dealing with in IT. What is an intermediary? I'll give you an example. In Delhi, I went to a policeman. I told him somebody is cheating on a fraud thing. So I told him, aap cyber expert nahi hai, cyber expert hai. Kya nahi, aaj main hi hu, aaj mujhe hi bataiye. Sorry for being in Delhi language, using the Hindi language here. But you know, ultimately he tells me, you know, अच्छा आपके पास ईमेल एड्रेस है, चलिए उस एड्रेस पे चलते हैं. तो यू आर थिंकिंग फॉर टू मिनट्स एंड माय कोलीग ऑलमोस्ट फेंटेड. ही डिडंट नो हाउ टू रिएक्ट. दी इंस्टेंटेनियस रिस्पॉन्स वाज, सर नहीं सर वो आईपी एड्रेस है. अच्छा आईपी एक्सटेंशन में है. आईपी एक्सटेंशन इज अ प्लेस विच इज इन दिल्ली, एनीबडी नोज इट्स ट्रांसमिना. सो वी जस्ट गेव अप. यू नो वी कुडंट डू एनीथिंग बियॉन्ड इट. सो आई थिंक दी more problem is in the execution. When it comes to our table as a fraud, the fraud has already happened, It's happened between the two customers, and the LEA didn't know how to handle it. They found this simplest scapegoat. अच्छा वो कंपनी थी उसको ठोक दो वो पैसा दे देगा. Very simple understanding of the matter. How do you handle it? Run court to court, try to explain to judge. Judges usually are much more savvy to the situations and much more amenable to the fact that we are an intermediary and spares us the trouble of not granting us a no stay. So usually we get a stay and usually we walk out from it. But imagine one gallow gets treated on a org. I am a .com, he's an org. He sues me. You go to GoDaddy and say, why did you give it to him? He says, no, I've got the right to do it. This is the kind of fraud which is perpetuating. The other kind of fraud is data theft. People randomly will do data theft from our side, put it on their side. Customer will call up and say, sir, वो एक HSM matrimony है, उसमें आपका नाम लगा हुआ है, वो कौन है भाई? वो हम नहीं है. नहीं नहीं आप मेरा नाम उधर है कैसे? How is my name there? You gonna fight this out? You can't. What do? You go file a police complaint. The police guy says, no, that guy is registered in Australia. I can't do anything about it. Then you go to remind him, section 1, boss, it says, if it is used in India, it's giving you a Lucknow or a Bhopal address of a franchisee, why don't you go raid him? They won't. They won't even take a complaint. So the sub part is the problematic area for us, is that police either doesn't take complaint or takes a complaint and takes evasive action against the postman or the intermediary, which is where we as lawyers have to interject and see how to protect our employees. I think that goes to him, Sumit, that goes to Ashish, and that I think Sandeep would be dealing with it on a daily basis, I think, being in a merchant. So you look at it from perspectives of crime. All companies, all genuine internet intermediary companies will not allow, will certainly never allow their websites to be used for fraud. They will have analytics team work on it, try to find out what kind of things they do as a regular practice, hunt them down, cut it. People who complain, good enough, fine. We use the intermediary rules of 2000 level, and we sometimes even misuse it. I've no pounds of selling it because it allows when you get a knowledge, deflate it off. It gives you the right. So when I do my analytics, I get a knowledge, I deflate it off. If the customer complains, I find him genuine, I allow him. Otherwise, it's deflated off, taken out of the system. But they will always find ways and means to get back. Leave one photo, take another photo, put it. How does it make a difference? There have been photos of married people into the system. They've been coming and hounding and saying, how did you put my photo? I didn't. So it is an evolving thing. It was there in the past, it's going now, it's going to be there in future, and it's going to be more complicated.
So you brought out this point on analytics, and I think analytics today is used for various reasons. One of them, of course, being to monitor your systems, to identify frauds. But I think maybe a snap deal, Ashish, you're also using it to maybe give the customer a better experience. So you're actually tracking some of the customer behavior. So in that scenario, how do you balance, you know, the need for privacy and how much information you use to target customers? What is the approach?
So I think this is a extension of what I said about artificial intelligence, right? So and it is what you are saying is, let's say, 2-3 notch below artificial intelligence, which we call it as a user behavior targeting, right? So I think these words somehow in the mind of people and regulators have become more negative word. But I think if you look at it from a user convenience standpoint, these are the real benefit which are offered to the user. Like I said, you know, I mean, if let's say there is some behavior targeting which is embedded into any of the e-commerce website, and you come to know through cookies and through my behavior that what I'm searching on the Google engine or, you know, where I'm going, you tend to know that, okay, he's feeling cold in the month of October, right? And I'm trying to go to some real life example so that you all can relate to it. Normally, if you are e-commerce website, you will start throwing much of the advertisement on winter wears in the month of November end or maybe in December. But here you have your customer who you believe through the data analytics that he is feeling cold, this guy is looking for a sweater, right? So why should I run my campaign en masse in the month of your November and December? Let me put a targeted advertisement for this guy in the month of October that, look, guy, come over here. I have a Monte Carlo sweater. I have a so-and-so sweater. I have a so-and-so sweater. So, but what we believe is that if some website like Snapdeal, Paytm, Bharat Matrimony, or say whatever, is trying to understand more of my behavior, then that's a risky proposition. Why? I'm not going to come to your home and to rob it. Till such time, you have adopted good data security standards. And let me tell you, no company in India open up the IT data security rule to say that what data standard I have to apply. Those were set in 2011. I think for our thing, that's an ancient age, right? It talks about some SAT 70 rule. People don't even open that law book. They say, what is the best international available standard? Let me apply that. I am more worried about my reputation than complying with the law, right? So, and I'm talking about law because I think Sandeep and Natarajan are the one who are more qualified to talk about law over here, is that let's accept the fact that sharing of more data with a credible partner is going to help you improve your daily life. And we need to change our mindset that if somebody tries to understand more of my behavior in terms of artificial intelligence, big data, data science and all, it's for your benefit. That company will earn some pounds extra, it's fine, right? But it's going to help you to find the goods at the right time, what you want. That way. So first is that regulators and we as the data subject have to change the mindset that over usage of the data, I'm not talking about security. If someone breaches security, you should, you know, put him behind the bars or you should impose penalty. Whatever law says, you know, you should take strict actions, right? But having said that, security there, no issues on that. Allow the service providers to understand you more. The more your wife or your husband understands you, the more relationship gets stronger, the more you feel comfortable with that person. Similarly, the more website where you, you know, pay or you find girlfriends or you buy something, the more they understand you, they would be able to service you better. So it's a change in the mindset which is very important for data subjects as well as for the government. I'm not talking about law enforcement. I'm sure Natarajan has completely taken out his frustration. If I start talking about, I may use some other Delhi languages, but yeah, that's aside. So I think it's more changing of the mindset. Allow people to help you understand more because you're spending more time on computer rather than spending more time on televisions or with your kids or with the family. Every time you're on mail, you're searching something, you're doing something that way.
Sandeep, you wanted to add?
You know, while I agree with Ashish about the various benefits of data analytics and artificial intelligence, I think the worry on the other side is as an individual, and you know, I'll just quote one example. So, you know, so there was this person in the San Francisco area owning a big house, and his son was going to go to college in the next 1 year. So there was a broker who was using data available from various websites who sent him a communication saying that I can help you sell this house, because he knew that once their kids go to college, these people are not going to want to afford a big house and move into a smaller apartment and so on. So I think it's a good example of, you know, if the house owner wanted that. But I think the problem arises when, let's say if I were the homeowner, I do not want the world to find out that my kid is going to go to college. I do not want anyone reaching me and saying, oh, by the way, do you want to sell your house? You know, so in other words, basically invasion of privacy. So I think the challenge is how do you balance the advantages that Ashish outlined with these kinds of challenges? And I think it'll be good to get their perspectives on that.
So, you know, as a PTM, I mean, you're dealing with a lot of sensitive data.
I just say that, you know, best thing is that, I mean, don't go to internet. I mean, see, we are now not in Web 1.0, Web 2.0. We are in the regime of Web 3.0, or maybe I would say 4.0. I think if you want to be private, just don't visit internet, I think, because I mean you go to internet because it's very easy, convenient, cost effective. You get to see the free information from Google, And for anybody, I'm not here to name the companies. If you are so much want to be so much private, I would say that if you are so pretty, the girls say, "I'm so pretty. I mean, walk out. I'm so scared that you know, guys will stare at me." Okay, don't go out of home. Just stay in the home. Don't see the world. Similarly, if you're too much scared about the misuse of or use of your data, then I think best case is that you will not find any answer from police, like what he said. You will not find any answer from business people because they want to, let's say, promote the services. But if you want to be not to be seen by the people, just don't use internet. Just I mean, stay away. I mean, that's what thing is.
Sandeep sir, I respect your question. So one point I wanted to put up here is there is a lot of discrimination between, and quote the word discrimination between system and person. So for example, you have a regular shopper, a regular shop where you go and buy stuff. And then when you walk into his shop and he sees that you are shivering and he offers you, sell that, "I have coat, fresh basket design," and he shows it to you. And you come in the morning and he offers you milk because he knows that you buy milk. You do not say that it is my intrusion of privacy. You and that person is also learning about you and gathering data. So because it is person, we are more kind to it, because there is no one entity who decided on the fate of what the data is going to do. But now that is one entity who is answerable to a million people or 10 million people or 100 million people, what will happen to one particular set of behavior or pattern. Therefore, some of the pattern, obviously you cannot please everyone, and therefore some of the person will get irked by that pattern. And that is exactly where I see that example of person not selling. So it may be possible that 70% of the people actually found it useful, but now because it is one system design, it will always work that way, and it will also offer to the rest 30% who may not be interested to sell. And therefore there is a discrimination between how do we treat people versus how do we treat systems. Because we would not say, "Why do you are offering me milk? I don't want it to buy milk. I wanted to buy bread." So that is completely acceptable because he is a human, he is just reacting out of his own self. So that is what systems and the programmers and the product managers behind are trying to do and trying to achieve that. And so, for example, take another example as well to illustrate this point. So for example, 5 years down the line, we have a driverless car, and now you're walking down and there are three lanes. You're walking in the middle lane, driving in the middle lane, and there's a big truck in front of you. Now, huge pile of stuff fall from the truck. Now you have three options. You either, and there is a SUV on the left lane, and there is a scooter on the right lane. Whatever you do, you can, and you will be allowed to do that. If you are a person, you hit into the truck and you die yourself. Okay, I could not react. If you go and hit the SUV, there will be some damage to you, some damage to the SUV. It will be still considered as a valid reaction. You wanted to save yourself 100%, and therefore you hit the scooter, and therefore the scooter person may die, but you will get survived. But in this case, on all the three scenarios, your response will be considered to be a valid response because it was out of a human reaction that was triggered. But now, when this decision is being taken by that programmer who wrote that code, that what would happen in such a situation, in any of the situation, you will say that this is stupid. If it hits the big block of the material that fell down, you will say that the programmer was stupid, he killed me.
So what you're saying is that it's like embracing the internet, and therefore you need to embrace some of the other aspects.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. So what I'm essentially getting at is that any time you cannot please everyone, and therefore there will always be this.
Yeah, so it's a question of choices that we are making, and maybe I think as we design products and services, some of these choices have to be built in.
Absolutely. Right? And I just want to add one more point here, that when this is a situation, you have to choose the lesser of better of the two evils. So if there are two people who will be using your data, this person uses my data but provides me with more genuine suggestions and genuine recommendation, I am more better off shopping and working with this particular set of people versus those people who are draconian and who try to take very, very drastic measure to sell me some stuff or decide upon my fate. So that is what, instead of giving one impractical suggestion, don't go to internet, go to better websites and better apps. That is my suggestion to you.
Just want to add a point of what Sumit is trying to say and what Amit is trying to converge into it. And I must put this point across. I've worked in telecom as well for about 7, 8 years, 9 years of my life. And, you know, they're also intermediary as access providers. No, they don't touch content rules. It's just a pipe. Now, what happens with an analytics of a company which plays with some data or hosts some data, temporarily or hosts it, is that it allows itself to have the data, analyzes, gives out certain information. Now, in the case of BharatMatrimony, he wanted the service, he wanted to hunt a life partner, so he has come to the website. In Snapdeal, he's usually going and hunting what he wants to do. Like he said, in the month of October, he prefers buying a sweater. Now, the problem with BharatMatrimony and with Snapdeal is not that they're offering something which the customer didn't want. Is that today, unlike telecom, which is a licensed activity, information technology isn't. So it gives you that leverage. And today in telecom, you have a D&D. It may not be far away that it comes on IT as well. And the draftsmen who sit in the Sanchar Bhavan understands a lot, but not everything. I think Beri Saab would have been discussing with a lot of them and finding the difficulty of speaking to an elephant sometime. So, but speaking on that proposition, I think the day is not far away when you start having do not disturb for even emails coming into the system if tomorrow the government wants to regulate. And if that happens, you know, I won't be able to throw up matrimonial alliances. They have to do it themselves. I won't have to send them the automated messages.
But then
they won't be able to send them the
automated
messages.
Where is it leaving the customer's consent and choice? I mean, are you taking away the consent, choice?
No, my terms and conditions say so clearly. No, my terms and conditions in BharatMatrimony says very clearly, I will give you options based on your set partner preference. I will give you options, no problem. Same he does. I'll give you options. I'm not saying that ultimately it's a cold. It's a cold call. But it is asked by him and I specified in my terms and conditions, and my terms and conditions are as per the 2011 intermediary rules as well. So it's not something the law does not provide. The law provides it. It's like where the law is going to be taken tomorrow is the question, in case we go on the line with Sumit is trying to say.
So, you know, just taking our, I mean, just extending this, Sandeep, the Shreya Singhal judgment and its aftermath on, you know, maybe the intermediary liability and also some security and privacy, the privacy norms. Where do you see that heading now? I mean, how?
So, and I think that's also a good illustration of the point we were discussing earlier about the responses to most recent events. So, Shreya Singhal happened in the context of a case that we, I think, all know about. So one thing that came out of it, which I think is generally being welcomed by everyone, is that you have taken away the concept essentially of private censorship. You have laid down that, okay, before you ask any intermediary to take down a particular content, it has to be backed by a court order or the order of a government agency. I think that's a good development. And it balances, you know, competing considerations. The one area that I think I personally worry about, and again that's in the context of what's been happening in our country, especially lately. You know, we all read about these, you know, cases of violation of modesty of women, with threats to circulate videos, you know, through various websites and so on. And I wonder whether, you know, if in those situations you need to get a court order or a government order before the website takes down that content, is that really an effective remedy? Wouldn't the damage have been done much before, you know, you get to that stage? So I would personally think that, you know, one possible way to balance various things may be that, you know, for certain situations like this, you carve out and say that, okay, for these things we are going to permit you a mechanism whereby you can be called upon to take down certain content right away. So that's what I would say on this.
I just wanted to add, so I totally agree with Sandeep sir, because what happens here is that by internet becoming such a big thing, the speed of things happening has increased a lot, and therefore our jurisdiction and our executive has to also operate at the same speed. So if you do not, the crime has already happened or the damage has already happened, and then you are reacting way later, then it can't help you. For example, if there is a phishing website, I need to take it down because my customer may be fooled into sharing those details. If I have figured out it's a phishing website, it is not what represents myself, I need to take it down almost instantly, because the time or the damage it will do is much, much faster than my jurisdiction can actually help me. So unless the policy provides for a response which is for this digital world, a quick response, and it is in alignment with the way the damage is happening, I think it will become very ineffective. So I think
that brings us back to the whole debate on responsibility and liability, right? I mean, if you know that it's a phishing site, and if you as the service provider have identified it, then it's possibly your responsibility and proactive action that you can arrest it rather than wait for somebody to tell you, right?
So I am restricted by, so it's not hosted by me, it's by some other website who is putting a Paytm logo and trying to fetch my customer's detail. Now I face the challenge that I know that this website or person is bad, I want this website to be taken down immediately, right? But I can't. And so that is a fight which I am facing right now, and that's why I ask that we need to have a provision where jurisdiction can be at least somewhat in line with the speed at which the damage or the fraud may happen.
Right. Ashish, you wanted to add something.
Yeah, so I'll just take a clue from Sandeep, and I applaud the Shreya single judgment. Actually, I know it has its own kind of downside, and what you have rightly said, but I think this is a right direction towards sending a strong message to the draftman, like, you know what you said, that whoever drafts the law doesn't know what he's drafting. That I think the key point was that the language of Section 66A was unconstitutional because it was too broad. Someone, I think, if you ask me, someone must be sleeping when he would be drafting that provision. And unfortunately, that is happening in all the statutes. It's not only limited to Information Technology Act. We have witnessed Companies Act. We witnessed Income Tax Act. We have witnessed Copyright Amendment Act. Right. So anyway. My point is that how do we educate about the intermediary liability beyond Department of Telecommunication, beyond the cyber cell, right? Let's take the example of an e-commerce website. Let's take the example of online payment website. We are facilitating third-party goods, okay? Let's say someone is selling something which is illegal to be sold, and they uses Paytm platform to make the payment, or they use a Snapdeal platform to advertise that product, or they use OLX to advertise the product, right? Now, there is a specific statute on that particular product. Let's take example of drugs, right, or medicines. There is a specific statute which is your Drugs and Cosmetics Act. But the unlawful action has happened on an intermediary, which is either a payment website or an e-commerce website. The enforcement is done by FDA. The enforcement is done by, let's say, police or economic offense wing for a copyrightable content. How are they aligned towards this intermediary liability and safe harbor concept? They apply the principle of strict liability, like what Sandeep said, that if it has happened on your website, you know, and you are the easy target, you come in the jail. So I think the need of the hour is to take a holistic approach on the intermediary liability and the safe harbor across all the law enforcement agency. It should not be restricted only to the cyber crime police. It should not be restricted to CERT. It should not be restricted to Department of Telecommunication. They understand. They have understood. They have digested it, right? But third party enforcement agencies have no clue, right? We have faced, I mean, I'm sure that, you know, all of us have faced similar issues where you have to deal with a third party enforcement agency who are not covered directly under Information Technology Act. भैया IT Act तो मुझे नहीं पता, मेरे को तो Drugs and Cosmetics Act पता है, मेरे को तो Essential Commodity Act पता है, Copyright पता है, मेरे को तो वहाँ जाना ही नहीं है, that's not my area, right? तुमने वो किया है, अंदर आ जाओ. So I think there's a holistic approach towards law enforcement investigation of an intermediary when it comes to some breach of some other statute, how they have to be investigated and covered has to be educated to the other law enforcement agency to give the real meaning to safe harbor of Section 79 of Information Technology Act. Otherwise, I think the Shreya Singhal will only be limited to whatever you post on a Twitter or a Facebook or on a YouTube.
Neil Kantanda, you had of course spoken about the horror of interacting with the cyber cell. Do you have any to add to it?
With inspectors other than the cyber cell. Cyber cell has been much more better, right. Much more better. It's the non-cyber cell guys who are tasked to do a particular job when the expert should be taking care of it is where you start breaking your head and saying, am I in the right place in the first place? Now, the whole concept of this Shreya Singhal judgment, you know, it's good in a way of taking down, but you go to the other end of it, Bazi, the problem of an intermediary hosting some kind of, which we do actually, all three of us do some kind of hosting. The problem is when there was a obscene content, the court actually said that, I don't mind, you may be exempt under the IT Act, but I'm going to prosecute you under IPC. Now, how are you going to handle a situation? How are you going to tell your CEO, sorry, I can save you in the IT Act, but I can't save you under the IPC? And Sandeep would have faced a lot of problems in that. I don't know, Ashish or...
I handle Smith. That paid case personally, so I can tell you outside. So so I actually handle that case. So
Sandeep, do you want to make a comment on the
Supreme Court? But no, I mean, it's all in the public domain now in the form of judgment. So I think IPC is more an offense which is related to the conduct of the human in person. And I think in that case, the liability was basically fastened on to, you know, one of the CEO and, you know, one of the senior manager. So how the law relates to that, what is his personal involvement? IPC is more about a personal involvement of a human being, right? IPC is not much about the vicarious liability. So Information Technology Act talks about vicarious liability, and hence you have company and director. So, I mean, we can talk offline on how we did the right kind of legal interpretation, help the court to understand
maybe
about
we can
these
have
things,
a separate session on that.
But
one,
yeah,
right?
to help you understand, yes, like what I said, that the education about the safe harbor of Section 79 has to be spread across all the law enforcement agency, so that there is a commonality of enforcement and interpretation of what is being done on an intermediary website like a matrimony website, payment website, and e-commerce.
I think that's
website.
A task that DSEI and NASSCOM would have to own and undertake. So I think we should take questions from the audience. We're open to questions if.
Who have websites, but they're actually selling the data to other people. Okay, just I'll give you an example. I came to Delhi. Okay, I got an SMS from TGIF in Saket. I don't know even where it is, saying that 20% off will come with this SMS. That means the telecom provider sold the data that I have come here, because I have never given data to TGIF. So what are your thoughts on that?
I want to take this question and I want to answer this question. One, telecom companies do not give data to anyone except the government of India on a monthly basis. It's the leakage happens only and only where it has been leaked. Let me give you a practical example.
No, there was a. I never give my data to any restaurant. Never. But still, but still this data has gone.
Yeah, okay. How, even
if you say that, you know, TGIF has my data, how will they come to know that I have come to Delhi? There's no chance, right?
So I'm giving you the answer.
So, it is good, it is in your interest, you get a SMS from TGIF, take your friends along, you get 20%. So let's just change the mindset. Why you are feeling upset about
no,
it?
I have a bigger question. Right? My question is, are we talking of user privacy in terms of you selling the data to other people at all?
Let me tell you the law in India, okay? It is under Section 43A and 72A of Information Technology Act, irrespective of what is there in Telegraph Act or maybe RBI guidelines that, I mean, Sandeep, you can speak to him offline. It says that if, because of the breach of data, there's a wrongful loss or wrongful gain, then only you have breached the law, right? So in this case, you ask yourself, if somebody has sent you an SMS by saying that come to a TGIF, I'll offer you an extra 20% discount, show me the code in your SMS. Is there any wrongful loss to you? No, there's no wrongful loss to you. Is there any wrongful gain to TGIF? No, he's offering you more, right? So one is that law interpretation is different.
No. I'm talking of data being sold to other people.
So I'm okay. saying that the
so I'm talking of,
breach
that.
Of data
so
has
I think it's
caused
a
wrongful loss or wrongful gain.
An
important
about,
thing
right?
is that you check the terms and conditions of service providers where you have signed up. Some people say that I will not sell your data. Some people say you hereby consent that I can share your data to my partners, business partners, stuff like that. You have signed up. Understand this thing. You have signed up for that. You're consenting.
That point is hidden in some terms and conditions on all the websites.
Read it.
So do you expect users to actually go through that? Do you say upfront, saying that this is my terms and conditions, I will sell data to third party?
Yeah.
Do you say that upfront or is buried deep inside terms and conditions, which nobody is going to read anyway?
So I'm sure you must have bought some properties in any of the fancy cities in India. I mean, I would ask you the same thing. Have you gone through each and every word of the agreement of the builder? I'm sure you must have signed bulky document with your employer. Have you gone through? You decide not to go through, that's your choice. It is available under law. It is conspicuously available on the property which you are accepting to use, right? I can't spoon feed everything to you that under so and so clause it's there. You read it. If you have any difficulty, there are plenty of lawyers available. Understand from them. It's a caveat emptor. Sorry, I am not defending this word.
It's not convincing, actually.
Yeah, I mean,
it's
it may not be convincing to you, but that's what the real world is.
I'm going to say how it is getting litigious.
Okay, let me give you an example. You know, I booked my, I'm coming from Chennai today morning. So when I booked my ticket, within 10 minutes, I got an SMS. Taxi for sure, Delhi, 20% discount from airport. It was just a pure chance. Nothing to do because I booked my ticket 5 days ago. I got the SMS 6 days ago. I'm sitting in Chennai for the last 8 months, I have not moved out. It may be also a chance that you got the SMS. I'm on D&D, yet I got the SMS. I could send it to the TRAI and they can actually give me some fine as well of $5,000. But telling that a telecom service provider provides data to third party is not going to happen. The leakage never happens from a telecom company. They don't even use the keys. They give it to the DOT saying, you come and use my keys. I don't even want my keys.
I think here the point here is that, you know, we are not giving explicit consent, so why should we be bombarded?
So all I'm trying to say,
I think it's a mix of situations here because we don't want to go through the 3-page terms and conditions which are written in abominably small fonts in grey color, which is so difficult to read, grey and yellow and grey and orange combination.
You invest
and this
in
is from
stocks?
A this is from a personal point of view,
no,
right?
No, if you invest in stocks, you know, you feel happy that
I have
invested in so and so stock, I have got 30% return. I think the font size in that SEBI document is far more smaller than what you would
agreed,
see.
Agreed.
At least
and
on the website you can expand and, you know, increase the font size, stuff like that. So we choose not to read it.
Yeah, agreed. So, you know, I think that's the other part that we as customers, as consumers might have to incorporate in our behavior as we try and go on the net and, you know, as they define, redefine how we, you know, do other activities.
See, also, what I'm trying to give him an option is to go on D&D, you won't get the message. That's the only solution possible because I cannot stop anybody from sending a computerized message.
Yeah.
Also,
mine is telecom operators only operate a pipe.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, whenever we sign up for any apps on our mobile, we consent the location to them. So Google Maps, where we are consented a location, is also an AdWords play. So we pretty much have consented them our location and we have allowed them to...
That's your personal choice.
Yes, absolutely. So in terms of how that might have come up, on every app that you sign up for, almost 80% ask you for the location and almost 80% ask you for the consent to advertise. So you have yourself chosen to...
To justify this, saying that everyone else is doing it, okay? So to his point, saying everyone else is doing it, so I also do it, so what's the problem? So my question is, if you take the responsibility to state that, yes, I am going to share data, I am telling you upfront, okay? Why should you justify this based on what other people are doing? Oh, you go to real estate, they're also you're signing something, and then I can also do the same thing. That's not a valid justification. No, my point, let me complete. So my point is, if you can make upfront what you have providing as a service and how you are collecting the data and sharing the data upfront, so that everyone is clear what you're doing and what you're not doing. With respect to telecom, this is an example I took. I'm not saying how and where and what happened, that's not my point. My point is just give me an example to cover a bigger area of user data privacy, okay, and to say that what you're going to do with the data. That is the point I'm trying to cover.
So, you know, we have a specific law on this under IT Act. It says that you have to show your privacy policy to the users in a conspicuous form, and I think it is by default that every website in its footer would have terms of use, privacy policy and content. And in the privacy policy, it is in the statute that you have to also give the disclosure that how you are going to use that particular data. So people are complying, all the sophisticated sites are complying with that. You need to just go and check their privacy policy. It would be under bold and underlined, and how you are going to use the data. In that, they will say that whether I am going to sell your data or I am going to use it only for my internal efficiency. It will just take you 30 seconds to click that, go to that particular your section and see whether am I going to give this data which will be sold with my consent. If you're not comfortable, don't accept the service. And it is already there, it is in the law, people are complying with that. It's just, you know, as I said, the education has not spread to the extent that people appreciate that how easily they can go and find out that what they are accepting in terms and conditions. To come back to Google, sir, if you understand how much Google and other companies spend on R&D to make sure that they give you such kind of nice application, right? They're not asking you to pay them even a single dollar. Google is free, right? So how do they make money?
Yeah, and absolutely, to his point, you cannot install several apps if you don't agree to the terms and conditions of sharing your location and data for marketing, and which is how they make their revenue. Yeah. So pretty much when you install the app, you have consented them to give your location when you enter Delhi to TGI. So that's pretty much, I guess, how it happens. So.
The question at the back.
Actually, I just have some comments on the this topic the gentleman said. Okay, so it is not just the data which you are collecting and the consent you are asking. It is not should not be a blanket consent. Okay, so it is written in between the lines. Okay, so I am an active user of Google and all the internet sites. On the Google, I have seen that whenever they are asking for some kind of consent, okay, they have clearly mentioned that this is for this purpose we are going to use it. Okay, so like whenever I'm searching for anything, they'll say whether you want an ad related to this one or you don't want it. So I can just uncheck that mark. Okay, so I don't get the ads related to that. So I have the right on or I have the control what I will be getting. So even if I'm browsing anything on the Google or searching anything on the Google, I don't get the related ads on my email box. But that is not the case with the any e-commerce site or the e-retail site. Because whenever I'm searching for just a sweater or shoes or books, I'll get bombarded by the that kind of mails which are offering me these things. Okay, so maybe that point of time I was looking for some books or something, but that doesn't mean that I need to be bombarded with this kind of data. Okay, so yeah, I clearly understand that when I logged into Snapdeal, I have checked that, okay, Snapdeal can send me the promotional offers, okay? But that doesn't mean that anybody who is related to Snapdeal, any merchant of the Snapdeal can start sending me the mails throughout the day,
Okay. So I think that's a feedback that's taken, and I think you can talk separately on the user feedback.
Can I answer that? There is an unsubscribe button in every email.
Yeah.
Please click on it, follow the link, close it off.
Yeah. Yes. There is an unsubscribe. Yeah. So it is just a blanket answer that, okay, I don't use the email. Okay, or I don't give my email, I just give the false email.
No, we've taken the feedback, and I think...
I think the overall point is that we need to go towards more flexible product. And I think as the companies and evolve, they will move towards that where you can set the frequency at which you can receive a notification.
I want
to be notified only like once a day or twice a day. By the way, Google offers you that functionality, but you can choose which apps do not throw you a notification or how often they can throw you a notification, how aggressive the application can become. So I think there are functionalities, and the smarter apps and the better products will survive the market. Those who take care of such requirements and needs. So that is definitely an input well taken.
It could be a product and a service differentiator. The last question.
Yeah, it's not a question actually. I just want to answer this question that there's a procedure guard location area update. Okay, so like if I'm going from Delhi to Punjab, I get a notification that I'm in Punjab. So it's not that my data is lost. It's just that like if you have visited that particular location like Saket, so like all the agency, they might have tied up with the Airtel. So once you reach that particular area, it automatically triggers the promotion. So basically the concept is with the location area, not with the data selling. So that
is there any question beyond this particular point? Does anybody have a question or a comment or an observation? If not, then I think we can close this discussion. Thank you very much, panelists, for spending time and sharing your point of view. And thank you all of you for listening. And of course, this debate, very good input to us as NASSCOM and DSCI. We have actionables clearly on awareness building. And as an industry association, also we have actionables in terms of debating how to offer more consent to customers as more and more internet and mobile enabled options and businesses develop. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, panel. We'll have a 15 minutes tea break, and we'll try to gather here by 12:15. Thank you.
And whatever risk or things we are exposing to the internet and to the overall network, it just opens up a new avenue of bad things people can do to you. And therefore, you have to be absolutely careful about what is critical for you and what are the critical systems and critical data. You have to be extremely strict about how do you use them and how do you actually provide it to your customers and merchants. So most of the times, in terms of, if I have to put it very layman terms, it is all about capturing the right intent and securing the process and the product as much as possible. And so I will also, maybe if you required, I can also talk about how difficult it sometimes becomes to design a good product, given that it will be system controlled, but
maybe. So we'll I think come to that as a differentiator. But coming to you, Sandeep, in terms of trends that we are seeing globally with evolving business models, and how somebody like Paytm didn't exist when the Information Technology Act was first drafted in the country versus today. I mean, how is the global and legal scenario changing with time? What are the key points of concern that we are seeing? How are the governments reacting to it?
I agree with everything that the three panelists have said in terms of opportunity and responsibility. I would just add that I think whether it becomes more of a responsibility or opportunity often depends on a lot of other social and political factors, and that also affects the global trend. So obviously one of the most recent examples is the attacks in Paris, right? So when something like that happens, for anybody, even in a democratic society, to say that I'm not going to vote for extreme measures which will limit some of your rights becomes very difficult, right? So it becomes very easy for the French government to say that I'm not going to allow the app that enables you to encrypt messages over your various websites or communications. So therefore, I think the one important thing for us to remember is that, and I'll address your question about the trends, but I think one important thing to remember is that the trends are always a product of, I would say, the most recent social or political events. And therefore, I think the point that Neil made that, you know, the legislative response, et cetera, when it's done only in the context of most recent events, doesn't necessarily serve our, you know, long-term goals of balancing different considerations. But basically on the trends, you know, as, I think as we all know, there have been three broad approaches to addressing issues of intermediary liability. One is the strict liability approach, where you're liable for everything, every content on your website. The other extreme is where you have no liability at all, which is the prevalent law in the United States, for example. And the third one, which is the more EU and India type of approach, is that, okay, if you fulfill certain conditions, you won't have liability. And you know, I don't want to sort of jump ahead, but you know, maybe once you get, I'm sure you'll be talking about Shreya Singhal and so on, then you know, we can add on to that.
Right, so Neil, if I go to you, you know, if you look at the liability perspective, what have been the challenges that you as a company have faced? I mean, you're dealing with the kind of data and the kind of service that you offer. Clearly, there is no return, right? I mean, Snapdeal can always be offer a no question asked return, but you can't, right? So what have been the challenges? You've been here for long, I mean, as a service provider.
So let me answer it in two parts, and maybe one, I'll add a sub-part to it as well. But the way problems are faced is always, and I'm quoting myself in the context that in Bharat Matrimony at least, I haven't found a case where the company was at fault ever. It was always a customer to customer interaction outside the system of Bharat Matrimony, which only introduced these two people, happening on a Facebook, never on a WhatsApp. On a Facebook page or on a page which is of, say for instance, mobile SMS, and in worst case scenario, a Yahoo chat or a Google chat. Now, all the money gets transacted through the Indian banking systems. Vulnerable people end up paying lakhs and lakhs of rupees, assuming to get quickly rich or get some expensive gift, and end up being plundered. That's the basic problem. This is the one set of financial loss. The other set of information that happens is, police will come up way in the night one day and say, this is very emergency, get it now. The reason for it now is because somebody has breached somebody's privacy. And that being a content which can be loaded on the internet, they want to know which is the IP address which he was always used, how can we track him down to arrest him immediately, and that's the kind of work that happens on the back end of things. So frauds are not something which is related to the company's operation, because it's a machine and there's no human intervention, so there is hardly any problem there for an intermediary. It's only when the customer puts precaution on the back seat or the backmost seat, and richness or intimacy in the front seat, that caution to wind takes the toll of a fraud. To compound this is a sub part of it, the compound this is, it goes to a policeman who is not a cyber cell expert. So you're actually trying to talk to a person who has no clue of what he's dealing with in IT. What is an intermediary? I'll give you an example. In Delhi, I went to a policeman. I told him somebody is cheating on a fraud thing. So I told him, "Aap cyber expert nahi hai. Cyber expert hai? Kya nahi? Aaj main hi hu. Aaj mujhe hi bataiye. Sorry for being in Delhi language, using the Hindi language here. बट यू नो अल्टीमेटली ही टेल्स मी ना, अच्छा आपके पास ईमेल एड्रेस है, चलिए उस एड्रेस पे चलते हैं. तो यू आर थिंकिंग फॉर टू मिनट्स एंड माई कोलीग ऑलमोस्ट फेंटेड. ही डिडंट नो हाउ टू रिएक्ट. दी इंस्टेंटेनियस रिस्पॉन्स वाज़ सर नहीं सर वो आई पी एड्रेस है. अच्छा आई पी एक्सटेंशन में है. आई पी एक्सटेंशन इज अ प्लेस विच इज इन दिल्ली. एनीबडी नोज इट्स ट्रांसमिना. सो वी जस्ट गेव अप. वी जस्ट गेव अप. वी कुडंट डू एनीथिंग बियॉन्ड इट. सो आई थिंक द मोर प्रॉब्लम इज इन द एग्जीक्यूशन. वेन इट कम्स टू आर टेबल एज अ फ्रॉड, द फ्रॉड हैज ऑलरेडी हैपन्ड. इट्स हैपन्ड बिटवीन द टू कस्टमर्स and the LEA didn't know how to handle it. They found this simplest scapegoat. अच्छा वो कंपनी थी, उसको ठोक दो, वो पैसे दे देगा. Very simple understanding of the matter. How do you handle it? Run court to court, try to explain to judge. Judges usually are much more savvy to the situations and much more amenable to the fact that we are an intermediary and spares us the trouble of not granting us a no stay. So usually we get a stay and usually we walk out from it. But imagine one gelo gets treated on a org. I'm a .com, he's an org. He sues me. You go to GoDaddy and say, why did you give it to him? He says, no, I've got the right to do it. This is the kind of fraud which is perpetuating. The other kind of fraud is data theft. People randomly will do data theft from our side, put it on their side. Customer will call up and say, sir, वो एक HSN matrimony है, उसमें आपका नाम लगा हुआ है, वो कौन है भाई? वो हम नहीं है. नहीं नहीं आप मेरा नाम उधर है कैसे? How is my name there? You gonna fight this out? You can't. What do? You go file a police complaint. The police guy says, no, that guy is registered in Australia. I can't do anything about it. Then you go to remind him, section 1, boss, it says, if it is used in India, it's giving you a Lucknow or a Bhopal address of a franchisee, why don't you go raid him? They won't. They won't even take a complaint. So the sub part is the problematic area for us, is that police either doesn't take complaint or takes a complaint and takes evasive action against the postman or the intermediary, which is where we as lawyers have to interject and see how to protect our employees. I think that goes to him, Sumit, that goes to Ashish, and that I think Sandeep would be dealing with it on a daily basis, I think, being in a merchant. So you look at it from perspectives of a crime. All companies, all genuine internet intermediary companies will not allow, will certainly never allow their websites to be used for fraud. They will have analytics team work on it, try to find out what kind of things they do as a regular practice, hunt them down, cut it. People who complain, good enough, fine. We use the intermediary rules of 2000 level, and we sometimes even misuse it. I've no pounds of selling it because it allows when you get a knowledge, deflate it off. It gives you the right. So when I do my analytics, I get a knowledge, I deflate it off. If the customer complains, I find him genuine, I allow him. Otherwise, it's deflated off, taken out of the system. But they will always find ways and means to get back. Leave one photo, take another photo, put it. How does it make a difference? There have been photos of married people into the system. They've been coming and hounding and saying, how did you put my photo? I didn't. So it is an evolving thing. It was there in the past, it's going now, it's going to be there in future, and it's going to be more complicated.
So you brought out this point on analytics, and I think analytics today is used for various reasons. One of them, of course, being to monitor your systems, to identify frauds. But I think maybe a Snapdeal, Ashish, you're also using it to maybe give the customer a better experience. So you're actually tracking some of the customer behavior. So in that scenario, how do you balance, you know, the need for privacy and how much information you use to target customers? What is the approach?
So I think this is a extension of what I said about artificial intelligence, right? So and it is what you are saying is, let's say, 2-3 notch below artificial intelligence, which we call it as a user behavior targeting, right? So I think these words somehow in the mind of people and regulators have become more negative word. But I think if you look at it from a user convenience standpoint, these are the real benefit which are offered to the user. Like I said, you know, I mean, if let's say there is some behavior targeting which is embedded into any of the e-commerce website, and you come to know through cookies and through my behavior that what I'm searching on the Google engine or, you know, where I'm going, you tend to know that, okay, he's feeling cold in the month of October, right? And I'm trying to go to some real life example so that you all can relate to it. Normally, if you are e-commerce website, you will start throwing much of the advertisement on winter wears in the month of November end or maybe in December. But here you have your customer who you believe through the data analytics that he is feeling cold. This guy is looking for a sweater, right? So why should I run my campaign en masse in the month of your November and December? Let me put a targeted advertisement for this guy in the month of October that, look, guy, come over here. I have a Monte Carlo sweater. I have a so-and-so sweater. I have a so-and-so sweater. So, but what we believe is that if some website like Snapdeal, Paytm, Bharat Matrimony, or say whatever, is trying to understand more of my behavior, then that's a risky proposition. Why? I'm not going to come to your home and to rob it. Till such time, you have adopted good data security standards. And let me tell you, no company in India open up the IT data security rule to say that what data standard I have to apply. Those were set in 2011. I think for our thing, that's an ancient age, right? It talks about some SAT 70 rule. People don't even open that law book. They say, what is the best international available standard? Let me apply that. I am more worried about my reputation than complying with the law, right? So, and I'm talking about law because I think Sandeep and Natarajan are the one who are more qualified to talk about law over here, is that let's accept the fact that sharing of more data with a credible partner is going to help you improve your daily life. And we need to change our mindset that if somebody tries to understand more of my behavior in terms of artificial intelligence, big data, data science and all, it's for your benefit. That company will earn some pounds extra, it's fine, right? But it's going to help you to find the goods at the right time, what you want that way. So first is that regulators and we as the data subject have to change the mindset that over usage of the data, I'm not talking about security. If someone breaches security, you should, you know, put him behind the bars or you should impose penalty. Whatever law says, you know, you should take strict actions, right? But having said that, security there, no issues on that. Allow the service providers to understand you more. The more your wife or your husband understands you, the more relationship gets stronger, the more you feel comfortable with that person. Similarly, the more website where you pay or you find girlfriends or you buy something, the more they understand you, they would be able to service you better. So it's a change in the mindset which is very important for data subjects as well as for the government. I'm not talking about law enforcement. I'm sure Natarajan has completely taken out his frustration. If I start talking about, I may use some other Delhi languages, but yeah, that's aside. So I think it's more changing of the mindset. Allow people to help you understand more because you're spending more time on computer rather than spending more time on televisions or with your kids or with the family. Every time you're on mail, you're searching something, you're doing something that way.
Sandeep, you wanted to add?
While I agree with Ashish about the various benefits of data analytics and artificial intelligence, I think the worry on the other side is as an individual, and you know, I'll just quote one example. So there was this person in the San Francisco area owning a big house, and his son was going to go to college in the next 1 year. So there was a broker who was using data available from various websites who sent him a communication saying that I can help you sell this house, because he knew that once their kids go to college, these people are not going to want to afford a big house and move into a smaller apartment and so on. So I think it's a good example of, you know, if the house owner wanted that. But I think the problem arises when, let's say if I were the homeowner, I do not want the world to find out that my kid is going to go to college. I do not want anyone reaching me and saying, oh, by the way, do you want to sell your house? You know, so in other words, basically invasion of privacy. So I think the challenge is how do you balance the advantages that Ashish outlined with these kinds of challenges? And I think it'll be good to get their perspectives on that.
So, you know, as a PTM, I mean, you're dealing with a lot of sensitive data.
I just say that the best thing is that, I mean, don't go to internet. I mean, see, we are now not in Web 1.0, Web 2.0. We are in the regime of Web 3.0, or maybe I would say 4.0. I think if you want to be private, mm-hmm. just don't visit internet, I think. Because, I mean, you go to internet because it's very easy, convenient, cost effective. You get to see the free information from Google. And for anybody, I'm not here to name the companies. If you are so much, want to be so much private, I would say that if you are so pretty, the girls say, I'm so pretty, I walk out, I'm so scared that, you know, guys will stare at me. Okay, don't go out of home, just stay in the home, don't see the world. Similarly, if you're too much scared about the misuse of or use of your data, then I think best case is that you will not find any answer from police, like what he said. You will not find any answer from business people because they want to, let's say, promote the services. But if you want to be not to be seen by the people, just don't use internet. Just I mean, stay away. I mean, that's what thing is.
Sandeep sir, I respect your question. So one point I wanted to put up here is that there is a lot of discrimination between, and quote the word discrimination between system and person. So for example, you have a regular shopper, a regular shop where you go and buy stuff. And then when you walk into his shop and he sees that you are shivering and he offers you sell that I have coat, fresh basket design and he shows it to you. And you come in the morning and he offers you milk because he knows that you buy milk. You do not say that it is my intrusion of privacy. And that person is also learning about you and gathering data. So because it is person, we are more kind to it because there is no one entity who decided on the fate of what the data is going to do. But now that is one entity who is answerable to a million people or 10 million people or 100 million people, what will happen to one particular set of behavior or pattern. Therefore, some of the pattern, obviously you cannot please everyone, and therefore some of the person will get irked by that pattern. And that is exactly where I see that example of person not selling. So it may be possible that 70% of the people actually found it useful, but now because it is one system design, it will always work that way, and it will also offer to the rest 30% who may not be interested to sell. And therefore, there is a discrimination between how do we treat people versus how do we treat systems. Because we would not say, why do you are offering me milk? I don't want it to buy milk. I wanted to buy bread. So that is completely acceptable because he is a human. He is just reacting out of his own self. So that is what systems and the programmers and the product managers behind are trying to do and trying to achieve that. And so, for example, take another example as well to illustrate this point. So for example, 5 years down the line, we have a driverless car. And now you're walking down, and there are three lanes. You're walking in the middle lane, driving in the middle lane, and there's a big truck in front of you. Now, huge pile of stuff fall from the truck. Now you have three options. You either, and there is a SUV on the left lane, and there is a scooter on the right lane. Whatever you do, you can, and you will be allowed to do that. If you are a person, you hit into the truck and you die yourself. Okay, I could not react. If you go and hit the SUV, there will be some damage to you, some damage to the SUV. It will be still considered as a valid reaction. You wanted to save yourself 100% and therefore you hit the scooter. And therefore the scooter person may die, but you will get survived. But in this case, on all the three scenarios, your response will be considered to be a valid response because it was out of a human reaction that was triggered. But now, when this decision is being taken by that programmer who wrote that code, that what would happen in such a situation, in any of the situation, you will say that this is stupid. If it hits the big block of the material that fell down, you will say that programmer was stupid, he killed me.
So what you're saying is that it's it's like embracing the internet, and therefore you need to embrace some of the other aspects.
No, yeah, absolutely. Right. So what I'm essentially getting at is so that any time you cannot please everyone, and therefore there will always will be this.
Yeah, so it's a question of choices that we are making, and maybe I think as we design products and services, some of these choices have to be built in.
Absolutely,
right?
And I just want to add one more point here, that when this is a situation, you have to choose the lesser of, better of the two evils. So if there are two people who will be using your data, this person uses my data but provides me with more genuine suggestions and genuine recommendation, I am more better off shopping and working with this particular set of people versus those people who are draconian and who try to take very, very drastic measure to sell me some stuff or decide upon my fate. So that is what, instead of giving one impractical suggestion, don't go to internet, go to better websites and better apps. That is my suggestion to you.
Just want to add a point of what Subhit is trying to say and what Amit is trying to converge into it. And I must put this point across. I've worked in telecom as well for about 7, 8 years, 9 years of my life. And you know, they're also intermediary as access providers. No, they don't touch content rules. It's just a pipe. Now, what happens with an analytics of a company which plays with some data or hosts some data, temporarily or hosts it, is that it allows itself to have the data, analyzes, gives out certain information. Now, in the case of Bharat Matrimony, he wanted the service, he wanted to hunt a life partner, so he has come to the website. In Snapdeal, he's usually going and hunting what he wants to do. Like he said, in the month of October, he prefers buying a sweater. Now the problem with Bharat Matrimony and with Snapdeal is not that they're offering something which the customer didn't want. Is that today, unlike telecom, which is a licensed activity, information technology isn't. So it gives you that leverage. And today in telecom, you have a D&D. It may not be far away that it comes on IT as well. And the draftsmen who sit in the Sanchar Bhavan understands a lot, but not everything. I think Beri Saab would have been discussing with a lot of them and finding the difficulty of speaking to an elephant sometime. So, but speaking on that proposition, I think the day is not far away when you start having do not disturb for even emails coming into the system if tomorrow the government wants to regulate. And if that happens, you know, I won't be able to throw up matrimonial alliances. They have to do it themselves. I won't have to send them the automated messages.
But then
they won't be able to send them the
automated
messages.
Where is it leaving the customer's consent and choice? I mean, are you taking away the consent, choice?
No, my terms and conditions say so clearly. No, my terms and conditions in Bharat Matrimony says very clearly, I will give you options based on your set partner preference. I will give you options, no problem. Same he does. I'll give you options. I'm not saying that ultimately it's a cold. It's a cold call. But it is asked by him and are specified in my terms and conditions. And my terms and conditions are as per the 2011 intermediary rules as well. So it's not something the law does not provide. The law, it's like where the law is going to be taken tomorrow is the question, in case we go on the line with Sumit is trying to say.
So, you know, just taking our, I mean, just extending this, Sandeep, the Shreya Singhal judgment and its aftermath on, you know, maybe the intermediary liability and also some security and privacy, the privacy norms. Where do you see that heading now? I mean, how?
So, and I think that's also a good illustration of the point we were discussing earlier about the responses to most recent events. So Shreya Singhal happened in the context of a case that we, I think, all know about. So one thing that came out of it, which I think is generally being welcomed by everyone, is that you have taken away the concept essentially of private censorship. You have laid down that, okay, before you ask any intermediary to take down a particular content, it has to be backed by a court order or the order of a government agency. I think that's a good development. And it balances, you know, competing considerations. The one area that I think I personally worry about, and again, that's in the context of what's been happening in our country especially lately. You know, we all read about these, you know, cases of violation of modesty of women with threats to circulate videos, you know, through various websites and so on. And I wonder whether, you know, if in those situations you need to get a court order or a government order before the website takes down that content, is that really an effective remedy? Wouldn't the damage have been done much before, you know, you get to that stage? So I would personally think that, you know, one possible way to balance various things may be that, you know, for certain situations like this, you carve out and say that, okay, for these things we are going to permit you a mechanism whereby you can be called upon to take down certain content right away. So that's what I would say on this.
I just wanted to add, so I totally agree with Sandeep sir, because what happens here is that by internet becoming such a big thing, the speed of things happening has increased a lot, and therefore our jurisdiction and our executive has to also operate at the same speed. So if you do not, the crime has already happened or the damage has already happened, and then you are reacting way later, then it can't help you. For example, if there is a phishing website, I need to take it down because my customer may be fooled into sharing those details. If I have figured out it's a phishing website, it is not what represents myself, I need to take it down almost instantly, because the time or the damage it will do is much, much faster than my jurisdiction can actually help me. So unless the policy provides for a response which is for this digital world, a quick response, and it's just in alignment with the way the damage is happening, I think it will become very ineffective. So I think
that brings us back to the whole debate on responsibility and liability, right? I mean, if you know that it's a phishing site, and if you as the service provider have identified it, then it's possibly your responsibility and proactive action that you can arrest it rather than wait for somebody to tell you, right?
So I am restricted by, so it's not hosted by me, it's by some other website who is putting a Paytm logo and trying to fetch my customer's detail. Now I face the challenge that I know that this website or person is bad, I want this website to be taken down immediately, right. But I can't. Right. And so that is a fight which I am facing right now, and that's why I ask that we need to have a provision where jurisdiction can be at least somewhat in line with the speed at which the damage or the fraud may happen.
Right. Ashish, you wanted to add something.
Yeah, so I'll just take a clue from Sandeep, and I applaud the Shreya single judgment. Actually, I know it has its own kind of downside, and what you have rightly said, but I think this is a right direction towards sending a strong message to the draft man, like, you know, what you said, that whoever drafts the law doesn't know what he's drafting. That I think the key point was that the language of Section 66A was unconstitutional because it was too broad. Someone, I think, if you ask me, someone must be sleeping when he would be drafting that provision. And unfortunately, that is happening in all the statutes. It's not only limited to Information Technology Act. We have witnessed Companies Act. We witness Income Tax Act. We have witnessed Copyright Amendment Act. Right. So. Anyway, my point is that how do we educate about the intermediary liability beyond Department of Telecommunication, beyond the cyber cell, right? Let's take the example of an e-commerce website. Let's take the example of online payment website. We are facilitating third-party goods, okay? Let's say someone is selling something which is illegal to be sold, and they uses Paytm platform to make the payment, or they uses Snapdeal platform to advertise that product, or they uses OLX to advertise the product, right? Now, there is a specific statute on that particular product. Let's take example of drugs, right, or medicines. There is a specific statute which is your Drugs and Cosmetics Act. But the unlawful action has happened on an intermediary, which is either a payment website or an e-commerce website. The enforcement is done by FDA, The enforcement is done by, let's say, police or economic offense wing for a copyrightable content. How are they aligned towards this intermediary liability and safe harbor concept? They apply the principle of strict liability, like what Sandeep said, that if it has happened on your website, you know, and you are the easy target, you come in the jail. So I think the need of the hour is to take a holistic approach on the intermediary liability and the safe harbor across all the law enforcement agency. It should not be restricted only to the cybercrime police. It should not be restricted to CERT. It should not be restricted to Department of Telecommunication. They understand. They have understood. They have digested it, right? But third-party enforcement agencies have no clue, right? We have faced, I mean, I'm sure that, you know, all of us have faced similar issues where you have to deal with a third-party enforcement agency who are not covered directly under Information Technology Act. Then, bhaiya, IT Act to mujhe nahi pata, mere ko to Drugs and Cosmetics Act pata hai, mere ko to Essential Commodity Act pata hai, copyright pata hai, mere ko to wahan jana hai nahi hai. That's not my area, right? Tumne wo kiya hai, andar aajao. So I think there's a holistic approach towards law enforcement investigation of an intermediary when it comes to some breach of some other statute, how they have to be investigated and covered, has to be educated to the other law enforcement agency to give the real meaning to safe harbor or Section 79 of Information Technology Act. Otherwise, I think the Shreya Singhal will only be limited to whatever you post on a Twitter or a Facebook or on a YouTube.
Neil Kantanda, you had of course spoken about the horror of interacting with the cyber cell. Do you have any to add to it?
With inspectors other than the cyber cell. Cyber cell has been much more better, right. Much more better. It's the non-cyber cell guys who are tasked to do a particular job when the expert should be taking care of it, is where you start breaking your head and saying, am I in the right place in the first place? Now, the whole concept of this Shreya Singhal judgment, you know, it's good in a way of taking down, but you go to the other end of it, Bazi, the problem of an intermediary hosting some kind of, which we do actually, all three of us do some kind of hosting. The problem is when there was a obscene content, the court actually said that, I don't mind, you may be exempt under the IT Act, but I'm going to prosecute you under IPC. Now, how are you going to handle a situation? How are you going to tell your CEO, sorry, I can save you in the IT Act, but I can't save you under the IPC? And Sandeep would have faced a lot of problems in that. I don't know, Ashish or...
I handle Sumit. That paid case personally, so I can tell you outside. So so I actually handle that case.
So Sandeep, do you want to make a comment on
Supreme Court? But no, I mean, it's all in the public domain now in the form of judgment. So I think IPC is more an offense which is related to the conduct of the human in person. And I think in that case, the liability was basically fastened on to, you know, one of the CEO and, you know, one of the senior manager. So how the law relates to that, what is his personal involvement? IPC is more about a personal involvement of a human being, right? IPC is not much about the vicarious liability. So Information Technology Act talks about vicarious liability, and hence you have company and director. So, I mean, we can talk offline on how we did the right kind of legal interpretation, help the court to understand.
Maybe
about
we
these
can have
things,
a separate
but,
session on that
but
one,
yeah,
right?
to help you understand, yes, like what I said, that the education about the safe harbor of Section 79 has to be spread across all the law enforcement agency, so that there is a commonality of enforcement and interpretation of what is being done on an intermediary website like a matrimony website, payment website, and e-commerce.
I think that's
website.
A task that DSEI and NASSCOM would have to own and undertake. So I think we should take questions from the audience. We're open to questions if.
Who have websites, but they're actually selling the data to other people. Okay, just I'll give you an example. I came to Delhi. Okay, I got an SMS. from TGIF in Saket, I don't know even where it is, saying that 20% off will come with this SMS. That means the telecom provider sold the data that I have come here, because I have never given data to TGIF. So what are your thoughts on that?
I want to take this question and I want to answer this question. One, telecom companies do not give data to anyone except the government of India on a monthly basis. It's the leakage happens only and only where it has been leaked. Let me give you a practical example.
No, there was a, I never give my data to any restaurant. Never. But still this data has gone.
Yeah, okay. Even if
you say that, you know, TGIF has my data, how will they come to know that I have come to Delhi? There's no chance, right?
So I'm giving you the answer.
So, it is good, it is in your interest, you get a SMS from TGIF, take your friends along, you get 20%. So let's just change the mindset. Why you are feeling upset about
it?
I have a bigger question. Right?
My question is, are we talking of user privacy in terms of you selling the data to other people at all?
Let me tell you the law in India, okay? It is 43A and 72A of Information Technology Act, irrespective of what is there in Telegraph Act or maybe RBI guidelines that, I mean, Sandeep, you can speak to him offline. It says that if because of the breach of data, there's a wrongful loss or wrongful gain, then only you have breached the law, right? So in this case, you ask yourself, if somebody has sent you an SMS by saying that come to a TGIF, I'll offer you an extra 20% discount, show me the code in your SMS. Is there any wrongful loss to you? No, there's no wrongful loss to you. Is there any wrongful gain to TGIF? No, he's offering you more, right? So one is that law interpretation is different.
No. I'm talking of data being sold to other people.
So I'm okay? saying that the
so breach, I'm talking of,
breach
that.
Of data
so
which has caused wrongful loss or wrongful
that's
gain.
An
important
about, right?
thing is that you check the terms and conditions of service providers where you have signed up. Some people say that I will not sell your data. Some people say you hereby consent that I can share your data to my partners, business partners, stuff like that. You have signed up. Understand this thing. You have signed up for that. You have consented to it.
The that point is hidden in some terms and conditions on all the websites.
Read it.
So do you expect users to actually go through that? Do you say upfront, saying that this is my terms and conditions, I will sell data to third party? Yeah. Do you say that upfront or is buried deep inside terms and conditions, which nobody is going to read anyway?
So I'm sure you must have bought some properties in any of the fancy cities in India. I mean, I would ask you the same thing. Have you gone through each and every word of the agreement of the builder? I'm sure you must have signed bulky document with your employer. Have you gone through? You decide not to go through, that's your choice. It is available under law, it is conspicuously available on the property which you are accepting to use, right? I can't spoon feed everything to you that under so and so clause it's there. You read it, if you have any difficulty, there are plenty of lawyers available, understand from them, it's a caveat emptor. Sorry, I am not defending this word.
It's not convincing actually.
Yeah, I mean, it may not be convincing to you, but that's what the real world is.
I'm going to say how it is getting leaked against you.
Okay, let me give you an example. You know, I booked my, I'm coming from Chennai today morning. So when I booked my ticket, within 10 minutes, I got an SMS. Taxi for sure, Delhi, 20% discount from airport. It was just a pure chance. Nothing to do because I booked my ticket 5 days ago. I got the SMS 6 days ago. I'm sitting in Chennai for the last 8 months, I've not moved out. It may be also a chance that you got the SMS. I'm on D&D, yet I got the SMS. I could send it to the TRAI and they can actually give me some fine as well of $5,000. But telling that a telecom service provider provides data to third party is not going to happen. The leakage never happens from a telecom company. They don't even use the keys. They give it to the DOT saying, you come and use my keys. I don't even want my keys.
I think the point here is that, you know, we are not giving explicit consent, so why should we be bombarded?
So and all I'm trying to say,
I think it's a mix of situations here, because we don't want to go through the 3-page terms and conditions which are written in abominably small fonts in gray color, which is so difficult to read, gray and yellow and gray and orange combination.
You invest
and this
in
is
stocks.
From a, this is from a personal point of view, right?
No, if you invest in stocks, you know, you feel happy that invested in so-and-so stock, I've got 30% return. I think the font size in that SEBI document is far more smaller than what you would see.
Agreed.
At least
and,
on the website, you can expand and, you know, increase the font size, stuff like that. So we choose not to read it.
Agreed. So, you know, I think that's the other part that we as customers, as consumers might have to incorporate in our behavior as we try and go on the net and, you know, as they've redefine how we, you know, do other activities.
See, also, what I'm trying to give him an option is to go on D&D, you won't get the message. That's the only solution possible, because I cannot stop anybody from sending a computerized message.
Also,
mine is telecom operators only operate a pipe.
So whenever we sign up for any apps on our mobile, we consent the location to them. So Google Maps, where we are consented a location, is also an AdWords play. So we pretty much have consented them our location, and we have allowed them to.
That's your personal choice.
Yes, absolutely. So in terms of how that might have come up, on every app that you sign up for, almost 80% ask you for the location, and almost 80% ask you for the consent to advertise. So you have yourself chosen to.
To justify this, saying that everyone else is doing it, okay? So to his point, saying everyone else is doing it, so I also do it, so what's the problem? So my question is, if you take the responsibility to state that, yes, I am going to share data, I am telling you upfront, okay? Why should you justify this based on what other people are doing? Oh, you go to real estate, there also you're signing something, and hence I can also do the same thing. That's not a valid justification.
No,
my point, let me complete. So my point is, if you can make upfront what you have providing as a service and how you are collecting the data and sharing the data upfront, so that everyone is clear what you're doing and what you're not doing. With respect to telecom, this is an example I took. I'm not saying how and where and what happened, that's not my point. My point is just give me an example to cover a bigger area of user data privacy. Okay, and to say that what you're going to do with the data, that is the point I'm trying to.
So, you know, we have a specific law on this under IT Act. It says that you have to show your privacy policy to the users in a conspicuous form. And I think it is by default that every website in its footer would have terms of use, privacy policy and content. And in the privacy policy, it is in the statute that you have to also give the disclosure that how you are going to use that particular data. So people are complying. All the sophisticated sites are complying with that. You need to just go and check their privacy policy. It would be under bold and underlined, and how you are going to use the data. In that, they will say that whether I am going to sell your data or I am going to use it only for my internal efficiency. It will just take you 30 seconds to click that, go to that particular your section and see whether am I going to give this data which will be sold with my consent. If you're not comfortable, don't accept the service. And it is already there, it is in the law, people are complying with that. It's just, you know, as I said, the education has not spread to the extent that people appreciate that how easily they can go and find out that what they are accepting in terms and conditions. To come back to Google, sir, if you understand how much Google and other companies spend on R&D to make sure that they give you such kind of nice application, right? They're not asking you to pay them even a single dollar. Google is free, right? So how do they make money?
Yeah, and absolutely, to his point, you cannot install several apps if you don't agree to the terms and conditions of sharing your location and data for marketing, and which is how they make their revenue.
Yeah.
So pretty much when you install the app, you have consented them to give your location when you enter Delhi to TGI. So that's pretty much, I guess, how it happens. So.
The question at the back.
Actually, I just have some comments on the this topic the gentleman said. Okay, so it is not just the data which you are collecting and the consent you are asking. It is not should not be a blanket consent. Okay, so the it is written in between the lines. Okay, so I am an active user of Google and all the internet sites. On the Google, I have seen that whenever they are asking for some kind of consent, okay, they have clearly mentioned that this is for this purpose we are going to use it. Okay, so like whenever I'm searching for anything, they'll say whether you want an ad related to this one or you don't want it. So I can just uncheck that mark. Okay, so I don't get the ads related to that. So I have the right on, or I have the control what I will be getting. So even if I'm browsing anything on the Google or searching anything on the Google, I don't get the related ads on my email box. But that is not the case with the any e-commerce site or the e-retail site. Because whenever I'm searching for just a sweater or shoes or books, I'll get bombarded by the that kind of mails which are offering me these things. Okay, so I maybe that point of time I was looking for some books or something, but that doesn't mean that I need to be bombarded with the this kind of data. Okay, so yeah, I clearly understand that when I logged into Snapdeal, I have checked that okay, Snapdeal can send me the promotional offers. Okay, but that doesn't mean that anybody who is related to Snapdeal, the any merchant of the Snapdeal, can start sending me the mails throughout the day.
Okay. So I think that's a feedback that's taken, and I think you can talk separately
can
on
I,
the user feedback.
Can I answer
feedback.
That? There is an unsubscribe button in every email.
Yeah.
Please click on it, follow the link, close
option,
it off.
Yeah.
Yes, that, it's, yeah, so there is an unsubscribe.
The
yeah, so it is just a blanket answer that, okay, I don't use the email. Okay, or I don't give my email,
so,
I just give the false
right,
email.
No, we've taken the feedback, and I think...
yeah, I think the overall point is that we need to go towards more flexible product. And I think as the companies and evolve, they will move towards that where you can set the frequency at which you can
yeah.
receive a notification.
Options to give into the
I want to be notified only like once a day or twice a day. By the way, Google offers you that functionality, but you can choose which apps do not throw you a notification or how often they can throw you a notification, how aggressive the application can become. So I think there are functionalities, and the smarter apps and the better products will survive the market. Those who take care of such requirements and needs.
So
that
right.
is definitely
so an
input
could be
well
a product
taken.
And a service differentiator. The last question.
Yeah, it's not a question actually. I just want to answer this question that there's a procedure guard location area update. Okay, so like if I'm going from Delhi to Punjab, I get a notification that I'm in Punjab. So it's not that my data is lost. It's just that like if you have visited that particular location like Saket, so like all the agencies, they might have tied up with the Airtel. So once you reach that particular area, it automatically triggers the promotion. So basically, the concept is with the location area, not with the data selling. So that
is there any question beyond this particular point? Does anybody have a question or a comment or an observation? If not, then I think we can close this discussion. Thank you very much, panelists, for spending time and sharing your point of view. And thank you all of you for listening. And of course, this debate, a very good input to us as NASSCOM and DSCI. We have actionables clearly on awareness building, and as an industry association also we have actionables in terms of debating how to offer more consent to customers as more and more internet and mobile enabled options and businesses develop. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, panel. We'll have a 15 minutes tea break, and we'll try to gather here by 12:15. Thank you.